Okay, welcome very, very much to Conversation. An honor and a privilege to welcome to the program Jes Leopold. He's a major scholar, and he's a writer, and he's also a radio personality increasingly, and he's been involved with the establishment of the Labor Institute and a public health institute, as I understand from your bio. And he's also written a number of really interesting, eye-opening, incredibly important books, one of which we have on the stand here. You can see a more recent one. We're going to talk about it in some depth. It's got an interesting title. It's How to Make $1 Million an Hour. And maybe you could read the subtitle, Les?
Sure. Why Hedge Funds Get Away with Siphoning Off America's Wealth.
Amazingly important question after 2008 and so forth. We're going to discuss that in some depth, and we're here in welcome, Les. And I wonder if we could kick it off for a little bit here. Is maybe you could just share in a personal kind of way your own background. Born and raised, a little of your educator, very briefly so. And then we'll get into a question of these hedge funds and what is the... the algebra or the reality of the financial world that ought to be made widely available to all of the citizenry to understand better what in the hell is going on in terms of the financial world. But your own background,
I'll do my
if you
best.
Would, please.
Yes, I'm a first generation immigrant kid. I was born on a chicken farm in South Jersey. Lived there for 10 years, and my parents moved to Northern New Jersey. I was lucky enough to be able to go to a good college. And
where was that, if I may?
I went to undergraduate at Oberlin College Ohio. Then I went to graduate school at Princeton University and the Woodrow Wilson School.
The Woodrow Wilson School. In Oberlin, is that like Antioch or no?
No, it's like Oberlin's more like. You know, Swarthmore. It's a small liberal arts college.
A really good school. Tutors? Do you have tutors and things?
No, we didn't have tutors, but it's a school where all the education is done to this day by faculty. There are no graduate students.
Oh, really?
You have direct access to the faculty. It's the first college in the country to admit African Americans and women.
Amen.
And
amen.
It was a stop on the Underground Railroad. It has a long tradition of progressive intellectual tradition.
A proud tradition.
I was very fond of the place, and very lucky to have my son going there now.
So and your family was encouraging and so forth. The family setting was educationally encouraging.
Yeah, they were refugees from Nazi Germany.
Oh boy,
luckily escaped the concentration camps and came here. Education was everything. That was
right. Okay,
everything.
Good.
Because they were working very, very hard, as all immigrants do.
Yeah.
And they were hoping for a better life for their kids, my sister and myself.
Right, right.
From there, I pretty much realized early on that I was not an academic. I had a terrific appreciation for people who were in the academy, but that I had, I thought, an understanding, something that allowed me to translate what I was learning in the academy to everyday people.
A wonderful, wonderful skill if you have that.
It's almost
it's
like,
so
explaining,
much needed.
It's like explaining it to my parents and my neighbors kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So I got involved and I ran into a... brilliant economist named David Gordon passed away at a young age, unfortunately.
Mm-hmm.
And he and I set up this institute in New York called the Labor Institute to design educational programs primarily on the economy for working people in trade unions and also people in community groups, environmental groups.
Was that right out of college? You did that or a little after?
That was kind of right out of graduate school.
Out of graduate school.
I had between college and I did some work in peace campaigns, anti-Vietnam War political campaigns.
God bless you. Yeah.
I spent a couple years being a campaign hack.
Uh-huh.
actually had a chance to work a little bit with Bill Clinton and others.
Yeah.
It was just that time where we were all kind of wandering around.
Yeah.
I chose a different direction. That wasn't for me.
Yeah, but you're an interlocutor between the citizen and the intellectual community. Let's just put it that way. Academic. That's a major need.
Well,
that
I kind of feel that if you're going to have a working democracy, you can't have the most important elements finance, for example,
being
hidden from view.
Yeah, right, right. Which tends to be the case and wants to be the case very often by the people that are in those positions representing those interests.
When I go around and talk about high finance, it's remarkable how few people have any idea of what's going on and how the enormous ripoff that took place in leading up to the crash in 2007-2008. People have a sense of it.
Yeah.
They have a feeling.
Right, right.
But the work, I was just talking to a
like Wizard of Oz.
Yeah.
Behind the curtain, they keep it behind the curtain, and they've got an interest in keeping the people in the dark, as
also,
it were. Yeah.
Also, there's something else. I was talking to a colleague today. You know, life, I came up with this phrase called ad hocism.
Yeah.
Life comes to us very fragmented.
Yeah.
Oh, you hear something about the Federal Reserve. You hear something about Wall Street. You hear something about, you know, General Motors. You hear something going on in Washington. It all seems discrete and separate information.
Yeah.
But in fact, it's connected. And what people tend to have trouble getting access to is a broader view that puts the pieces together.
Yeah, and pattern recognizing, systems thinking, does any of that help?
No, no. That's what drives me all the time.
Okay.
That I write a lot of blogs for Huffington Post and Alternate.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Those are the two places I write for.
But what was the second?
Alternate.
Oh, Alternate. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, they're wonderful. That's that's my first obligation is to them.
Good.
What I'm looking for in the pieces that I write are precisely pattern recognition.
Right, right, right.
I'm looking for the connections, and I came to writing actually very late in life.
Okay.
In fact, my sister, my older sister, is the real writer of the family.
Okay.
She was the bureau chief for Reuters at the UN.
Wow.
And she's
she's
actually a Huffington Post correspondent right now for the UN in her retirement. But she was the real writer. I had some sort of learning disability. I couldn't spell.
Uh-huh.
It was really hard for me to spell. My grammar was all messed up. Maybe it's because German was my first language when I was growing
up. Also, the English language is pretty weird. I mean, if you're Spanish, if you can say it, you can write it. But English, they got all these cockamamie kind of connections.
But my life changed.
Yeah, okay.
When spell checker came in.
Yes!
When computers came in with spell checker, it changed my life. And I started to realize that I could express myself and I learned from a lot of other good writers.
And all this technology can be beneficial
to
moi.
That was very beneficial for me. My first book was not on finance. It was about this labor leader who had passed away in 2002 named Tony Mazzocchi.
Okay.
And he was probably one of the most unknown labor people in the country, and probably one of the most influential. He was the person that was responsible for the passage of OSHA.
Okay.
The whole idea of the modern health and safety movement more or less came out of his head.
Uh-huh.
And he was, you know, incredible innovator. He also is interesting. He had a very good story. So I wrote this biography.
As a book.
Yeah, it's called The Man Who Hated Work and Loved Labor.
Okay, right. Okay.
So that was my first book.
Yeah.
And you know, it was okay.
But was it a joy to write? Did you enjoy writing?
Oh, this is what I was just about to say.
Yeah.
It was an out-of-body experience. I had no idea. Mm. I loved it. I hated for it to be done. The process of writing was miraculous for me. I loved starting a chapter looking at a blank screen and then just watching it appear. It was like the book was writing
magic
itself.
Magic finger.
You know, I had good editors to help. They did a wonderful job to, you know, really make my ideas clear.
No, I understand, right.
But it was just a thrill writing it. So as soon as I got done, I said, what am I going to do next? I got to do
some more of this writing stuff.
Oh, yeah,
stuff.
This is incredible.
Right. Yeah.
So what happened was, this is a weird story, but what happened was my in-laws live in a area of Wisconsin right near Milwaukee, and the school systems in that area had basically lost $200 million in a financial scam, scam, right before this was in 2006, before the crash.
Yeah.
And they got involved in something called a synthetic collateralized debt obligation.
Oh boy, that sounds like the one. That's like Russell Baker used to talk about. He got his eyes glazed over. They started talking about runchables. Right. I don't know if you remember that article.
So yeah. What I was trying to do was I said, okay, if I could figure out what those are, I could have a book just explaining that to the public.
Thank you. That would be very good. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
So what happened was I started to do some research on it, and I remember I bought this used textbook. It cost me $90 used.
Wow.
And I got three pages in and I couldn't read it.
Yeah,
anymore.
Right, right.
It
became,
no, it became, it was all math.
Yeah, right.
It was,
yeah,
it was page right. after page right. after these yeah. These equations that were
it
getting
became
more
undecipherable by
for
any
me,
common mind. Yeah.
So
yeah.
I put the book down. Mm-hmm. I put the project down. My family we went away on vacation.
Didn't you do another book? You've done three,
coming up.
Haven't you?
Yeah, yeah, coming up.
Okay, yeah.
I come back.
Yeah.
This is the fall of 2007. Yeah. All hell is breaking loose.
Yeah.
All hell is breaking loose on Wall Street. And turns out that these synthetic collateralized debt obligations were at the heart of the story.
I'll be damned. Isn't that
And now
something?
The internet was filled with information.
Mm-hmm.
So within 3 months, I wrote the book.
Oh, wow. You could get the information.
Yeah, I was
you,
ready.
You needed to have a translator of the stuff so you could translate to the public.
Right.
Yeah.
I needed one more step.
One more step.
So I wrote this book
a one-step program, right?
I wrote this book called The Looting of America.
Uh-huh. That's it, yeah.
Yeah, and that did pretty well.
Uh-huh.
So from that, that was with a kind of small publisher. So I said, let me try going up another notch.
You got Wiley, didn't you?
Now I got Wiley.
Yeah, you got a major publisher.
Yeah, so I decided to go with a major publisher.
Uh-huh.
And this time, here's what got me into this book.
Please.
As I was researching The Looting of America towards the end, I came across an interesting statistic, a factoid, as they call it these days. And it was that the top, somebody called the hedge fund manager, the top one in 2010, this is 2 years into the crisis.
Right, right.
He made as much in 1 hour, as the average family made in 47 years.
It's amazing.
1 hour equals 47 years.
Yeah. Is there any other analogous
None.
To that? Any
Nothing.
Other role?
No.
Or Henry Ford? Anybody?
Never.
Or no?
Never.
Never
well,
anything
oh,
like
that? You know, if we... we'd have to do a lot of jiggering in terms of the value of the dollar.
No.
You know, maybe... that might have been the case with the Morgans and Henry Ford.
Yeah, maybe.
Versus, maybe, because the average value was so low.
Yeah.
But now, then...
Staggering. And what did they do?
Well, that was the point.
Well,
we don't know what they did.
Right. He's behind that curtain, Mr. Oz. Or
the next factoid I came up with, that this guy, his firm, which had fewer than 100 employees in 2010, made as much profit, his firm, personally, made as much profit as Apple.
I mean,
and
God,
Apple
my
has 700,000 employees and contractors around the world.
Right.
700,000.
Yeah, right.
And we know exactly what Apple does, right?
Yeah,
produces products.
Great technology.
And that people like and buy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, iTunes and other things. We know exactly what they do. Still, we have no idea what these hedge funds do. Then the next thing I did was, now I'm getting into thinking out a book design. I said, well, how rich are these guys?
Yeah, how rich can you
be? Well, I thought, well, let me compare them. You know, in America, the first, when I started talking to other people about it, they say, well, you know, this is a rich country.
Yeah.
Why are you picking on these guys? Who cares what they do?
Yeah.
I said, I don't think they're just your average rich guy.
No, there's something really out of whack.
The first chapter of this book is a product of this research. We went out and we got the top 10 earners in a variety of fields. The top 10 sports stars.
Right.
The top 10 movie stars.
Right.
The top 10 lawyers.
Right.
The top 10 movie directors.
Yeah.
Celebrities.
Yeah.
On and on and on.
Yeah, yeah.
The people.
Baseball.
The glamour thing. People.
Yeah, right.
And
these
hedge fund guys, CEOs, regular CEOs as well. The hedge fund guys made from 50 to 100 times more per year.
And we don't even know what they do.
And we don't know what they do.
Well, now, do you have some understanding, having written this
book?
Okay, well, that's what we want to find out.
Yeah.
I think we all want to find out. It's not an analogous, it's not generally, let's say, your investment bankers or your J.P. Morgan or you know, the major. Are there anything analogous to that in what is thought of as the normal plutocratic control of the economy?
It's very interesting.
What I mean.
Yes. hedge funds are basically investment funds. They exist in two forms. They exist inside of the largest banks, and they're called the proprietary trading desk.
So they
exist inside of the major banks, and they exist separately outside as hedge funds.
And why the two are entwined. Why inside and outside would be a
question. Because the big banks want to make a lot of money. They want to make $1 million an hour. So they use it to extract wealth from the economy.
So the same algebra that is being used, or the same equations being used, is the same within the major banking companies as these others that are what?
Freestanding.
Freestanding.
Yeah, let's try this.
Yeah.
We've been using the analogy a lot.
AIG, where does it fit in?
No, AIG is different, a slightly different game.
Okay.
But when we talk about gambling, casino, the casino part of the two big banks are their internal hedge funds.
Okay.
These are the heart of the casino.
Mm-hmm.
And my job in this book is to deconstruct it.
Yes.
So all of us can understand exactly what they do, and to answer a couple of fundamental questions.
Uh-huh.
The first question is, what do they do?
Yeah. Right.
And the second question is, do they produce value for the economy commensurate to how much they make?
Okay.
So, for example,
in general, in society, a
capitalist economy more or less works as following. You get paid what the market thinks you are worth.
Okay.
And that's supposed to equal the amount of economic value that you produce.
Right.
So if you, I'm Bruce Springsteen, let's say.
Yeah.
I entertain you,
you
pay me.
Yeah.
Right? And so there's an exchange of value. I produce a lot of entertainment value for you.
Right.
You're going to pay me for that.
Right?
That's an exchange of value that we can understand.
Right.
So the first question, sometimes, though, in an economy, you can have an exchange in a free market economy, supposedly, you can have an exchange that's not a fair exchange. So for example, a monopoly can jack up prices and create extra profit without producing any extra value at all.
Okay.
That's why we have an antitrust provision. That's why Teddy Roosevelt, back at the turn of the 20th century, busted the trusts, because the trusts were were trying to extract extra value.
Yeah, and so, the testing the limits of this has resulted in crash after crash after crash all through the whole of the economic history of the world, it seems, almost. It'd be a boom and a bust,
There's booms and busts, pretty much.
There's cycles that are
we were able to tame those. Since the Great Depression, we've been able to continue.
Yeah, it was such a tremendously...
we learned.
Know. Yeah.
Until we forgot.
Yeah.
I'll get to that part of the story.
Yeah.
So the next thing that happened here with this book is I had to ask the question, is this a ripoff here?
Mm-hmm.
Are these people making all this more money than anybody else by a factor of 10?
Or are they adding value?
Or are they adding value?
I can't quite see, but it must be there somewhere.
Well, exactly.
Yeah, right.
So I looked at the literature, they're what I call the hedge fund cheerleading literature. And these guys come up with things like, you know, hedge funds are as valuable to the economy as the innovators of Silicon Valley.
Wow. Yeah.
Literally, they say that.
With a straight face.
Oh, definitely with a straight face.
Mm-hmm.
So I start to look carefully at their arguments, because you know, I tried to make this as honest an exploration as I could.
Uh-huh.
And when I looked into it, Emperor had no clothes.
Yeah.
The arguments, just on the logical basis, you know, I go through them one at a time here, made no sense to me. These were not Silicon Valley innovators. That's not the arguments they were using were fluff.
Uh-huh.
So then I dug a little deeper, and it turns out that the most some of the most quote unquote valuable things that they do that make them the most money, the rest of us would call cheating.
Yeah, right.
Some of it's legal, some of it's barely legal,
and
some of it is absolutely outright illegal.
Okay. Was it tied into anything that was happening and becoming available that hadn't been historically through the cyber developments or not? Was it tied into that? Because those things evolved, and a lot of those formulas they got down to being able to work out by having such large numbers they could crunch in a computer that gave them something that hadn't been available throughout history.
Let me follow up on that.
Okay.
Let me give you examples of some of the major ways that hedge funds make money.
Okay,
example
okay,
number one,
okay,
that,
yeah.
up your alley in terms of technology, is called high frequency trading.
Okay. Yeah.
So what a certain group of hedge funds do is they place their computers, they rent space right next to the stock exchange. Like over
you
where
mean
the stock
physically?
Physically,
yeah.
where the stock exchanges have their computers. They put their computers, their very expensive, state-of-the-art, you know, ultra-high-frequency, high-speed computers next to it so that they get the feed from the stock exchange
a quarter
faster.
Of a second or something more.
Nanoseconds.
Nanoseconds.
They operate in a world of nanoseconds.
Right.
So they get it way before you do on your computer.
I'll be there.
So
okay.
So what they do is they they buy and sell automatically with these. They hire a team of very very good programmers, mathematicians, physicists, and they model this world of nanoseconds.
Uh-huh.
So if you're sitting at your computer and you want to buy some shares on E-Trade, and you press the button that says buy, by the time your trade goes through, a high frequency trader has bought the stock and sold it back to you at a slightly higher price.
I'll be damned. Well, how would you know it would be a slightly higher price? Why?
You don't wait until you see your final price. You might have thought you bought it at $12.12 and ended up going through at $12.15.
And they
got the 3 cents.
Okay. What if they bought it and then it went down? It couldn't
then
go
they're
down.
Doing the other way too.
Yeah,
they
would have a thing of shorting
they're
on
selling,
it.
Yeah, they could do ahead of.
They could lose if it goes down, or they could win if it goes down
it,
or up. Right?
Yeah, you're going here to get it. Yeah. They're standing in the middle and going like that and taking a fee.
Well, that's like something that's supposed to not happen. It's like something that's not supposed to be conjured out of reality. You can't win, lose going
they
both ways.
They make millions of trades a minute.
And that's what
one guy actually
now,
said.
Now is that legal?
Yes.
It's legal.
Yeah.
And it's recognized for what it is?
Yeah.
Okay.
50 to 80% of every trade on the stock market is from a high-frequency trader.
How much?
50 to 80%.
Of everything?
Of the whole volume of the stock market are high-frequency traders.
Okay. And these high-frequency trader things are subject to these kind of manipulations.
That's what they do.
On a routine basis.
They make from $5 to
$20
billion a year.
How much of the overall thing of hedge funds is these high-frequency traders?
A little hard to know. The estimate's about $120 billion worth.
No, but in percentage terms of the whole hedge fund megillah.
10% maybe.
10% of that. So that's one that you're describing.
Yeah.
One part of that.
One of the guys had kind of confessed, and he said he had not had a losing day in 5 years.
That's pretty unusual for investment banking.
And, catch this, the longest he ever held a stock, for him, a long-term hold, was 2 seconds.
I'll be damned. I'll be damned.
So this was like, one guy called it like shooting fish in a barrel.
Yeah.
That's how easy it was for him to make money.
Right.
They do all kinds
of
things.
But I don't quite understand. How can they do it? How can they bet either way and still make money?
Well, if you're selling.
Wait a minute. Let me see. You're selling. Yeah.
If you're selling.
You buy it for 12, let's just say, and it sells for 12.1 or it sells for 11.9.
Either way you go, they're in the middle of your trade without you
knowing
it. But
you'd have to be calling the right way for it to
go.
If you buy it at 12 and then it goes down to 11.9, you sell it to him for 11.9, then he's going to get it cheaper, the person you sell it to, and the things will fluctuate that
either way. If he's selling, he's getting a lower price than he should get, and if he's buying, he's paying a higher price than he should get because this high frequency trader bumped up the price or bumped down the price just a little bit each time.
I'm sorry, I can't understand.
You want to buy something.
Yeah.
You want to buy
for 10.
For 10, right?
Yeah.
You think
high frequency trader buys a thing for 10 in a nanosecond.
You're going to be paying $10 and 2 cents.
2 cents.
You're
but what if you what
you want to sell it at 9? Let's say you want to sell it at 11.
Yeah.
A couple of weeks later, whatever you want to sell at 11.
Yeah.
You're going to get 10.58.
But he controls it. He buys it at 10, and what happens if in that nanosecond the price that he's able to be got for it by a buyer is 9?
He's tacking on a hidden tax for you. He's getting in
so it never goes down.
No,
after he buys it,
whether you buy it or sell it, he's taking
in this
a tax.
Nanosecond world. Yeah, that it isn't possible for that thing that he bought in a nanosecond.
It's not moving.
To be valued less and not be able to sell for less than he paid for it.
He's operating so quickly, he has no chance of losing any money.
Okay.
And you're paying a little bit more than you should have been paying to buy, and you're getting a little bit less than you should have been getting when you sold.
A high-frequency trader.
They're invisibly in there.
It's along about then that there came along within the modern world, I think the International Swaps and Derivatives Association got started about 1990 or something like that. So you got derivatives also.
You want derivatives?
And you've got swaps and derivatives was introduced into the market equation. Ooh. How does it relate to the hedge funds and to the thing that you're invigorating?
Okay.
Where does it fit in?
Another technique.
I mentioned an AIG was huge. It's like reinsurance.
Right.
Like Switzerland or something.
Let's get the fundamental part
okay.
of the day.
Okay, by all means. Sorry.
No. That's not, no need to be sorry. Here was the number one money-making technique before, during, and after as the crash was happening. Here was the technique. It was designing a financial product that would fail so that the seller could collect insurance on it.
From AIG, he was one of the largest, right?
Put AIG aside right here.
Okay.
You got to get the basic of the story now. Forget about AIG.
Okay.
In capitalism.
Yeah.
Nowhere else in capitalism are you allowed to do it. I want you to appreciate how weird this is.
Right.
Imagine I build you a house, right? I'm the builder and the seller.
Right.
I build you a house. I design it so that it's going to fall apart in 6 months.
Right. Okay. Yeah. You design that. Right.
I design that.
Yeah. And then you want it to fall apart.
Right. And then I take out the insurance on it.
Yeah.
So that when it collapses, you don't collect the insurance. I collect the insurance.
I see, right.
Now, that's illegal in capitalism.
How was it able to be done so widely?
Hang on. It's illegal in capitalism. They figured out 800 years ago that if I take insurance out on your house, I will burn your house down.
Yeah, right.
Or I'll send somebody else in to burn
your
house down.
If you're the one who gets the premium.
I am not allowed to produce a drug that's going to kill you so I can collect on your life insurance policy.
Right.
In high finance, this was legal. Mm-hmm. Here's what they did.
Had it always been, or was there some point when that could have been obviously seen?
It certainly was not possible
when
it changed.
Regulations changed
it.
Regulations.
Here's what they did.
Yeah. And what year frame are we talking about where the thing really started?
It started around 2000. This idea was invented in the late 1990s or 1996 something, but it became really prevalent. From 2005 to 2008 is when they really cranked this up.
Right.
And here's what they did. Between 2004 and 2006, the big banks realized that a lot of these mortgages that were put out, these subprime mortgages with the teaser rates, were going to jump up. And a whole lot of people were going to go into default.
But they wanted them to fail.
Hang on, don't jump ahead of me on the story. We're going to get lost.
All right.
So they had securities that were based on these mortgages, on the payments of these mortgages, and they knew there were going to be a lot of defaults. So that meant that their securities were going to be worth a lot less.
Could that go into the bond market?
These are
they
bonds.
They were bonds.
So these are bonds.
Can get a rating from Moody's or something?
They got AAAs and all that. But they had this junk.
Yeah.
They saw stuff on their books that was about to turn into junk.
Yeah.
So they wanted to get rid of it.
Yeah.
So what they did is they worked with hedge funds.
Mm-hmm.
And these hedge funds went out and they found the mortgages, pools of mortgages all around the country.
And pooled them?
That were in the worst places.
Yeah.
That were going to have the highest default rates.
They wanted that.
They were looking for them.
Yeah, okay.
They wanted to find the worst junk that they could find in Las Vegas, in Arizona, in Florida, right? The places where they knew there was been a big boom in alternate subprime mortgages. They knew the brokers were unscrupulous.
Right.
And they were giving them out to people with no income verification, pulse verification.
Yeah,
they could be dead and they would get a mortgage.
Yeah.
So they found those, they packaged them all together, right?
And sold them as a bond?
They sold them as a bond, and then they bet against them.
Hey, God.
Now, I'm not making this
yeah,
up.
Yeah, yeah.
One of the guys, one guy, did this, and the investors lost $1 billion.
$1 billion is
Goldman
real
Sachs,
money.
It was Goldman Sachs and a hedge fund guy.
Yeah.
The investors lost $1 billion. The hedge fund guy made $1 billion.
Wow.
Now, the SEC investigated.
A billion with a B. Yeah.
The SEC investigated this. There's a whole government.
Have they got the facilities to do that or the capability?
On this one, here's what happened.
I mean, in general. I mean,
Congressional committee got at this.
Yeah.
And this congressional committee.
They haven't got the financing.
They did it, though.
Okay, go ahead.
They
go ahead.
Really
sorry,
did a number.
Mean,
no, there's.
That is a question, is a systemic thing of the whole economy that they don't have the ability to keep up with these
guys. Yeah, that's why we got to destroy the big banks.
Yeah, okay.
Because we'll never have the ability to keep up with them. We've got to get rid of them.
Okay.
That's another part of the conversation.
So,
they investigated them, and this whole slimy deal came out. Mm-hmm. Goldman Sachs had to pay a $550 million fine. Their stock, of course, because it was chump change, their stock went up 5% after
right,
the fine.
Yeah, right.
Guess how much the hedge fund guy had to pay?
I can't understand. I can't imagine. I have no way of guessing.
Zero.
Oh, well. Okay,
because
that seems fair to us.
He got to keep his $1 billion.
Yeah, yeah.
This is one of the slimiest deals ever. Goldman Sachs did this with a hedge fund. J.P. Morgan Chase did it with a different hedge fund. Citigroup did it with different hedge funds. They all paid enormous fines, and the hedge funds got to keep all their money.
Oh, wow.
Now, so I asked my question. Here's the question. Yeah. What value did that create for the American economy?
Right.
And I'll tell you the value it created. Right. It created negative value because it accelerated the crash.
Right.
Because now you had these investors who in 6 months lost $1 billion.
Yeah.
And you had all these mortgages that now were mortgage bond related instruments that were crashing.
Yeah.
And you had these toxic assets all over the place because they couldn't make enough of these things.
Uh-huh.
When the economy was going up, they made them and sold them as good investments.
Right.
And when the economy started, the bubble started to burst, they accelerated the burst and started to sell this stuff by finding the worst stuff and then betting against it.
Good God.
So they created negative economic value, and this was the pinnacle of their success. They wrote books about these guys, about how smart they were.
Mm-hmm.
These were the people that knew the housing market was going to collapse.
Right.
They took on the big banks.
Yeah.
They did not take on the big banks.
Uh-huh.
It was like David and Goliath were on the same team.
Yes, right.
They
right.
worked
Tag
together.
Team. Yeah,
they were,
yeah.
they were
yeah.
a partnership.
Uh-huh.
And then
uh-huh.
they got exposed afterwards.
Uh-huh.
So when I saw that, I said, you know what?
Uh-huh.
This is a problem.
Uh-huh.
Well, that was just another technique.
Mm-hmm.
You know what this most simple one is?
Mm.
How you make money?
Yeah.
Let me back off here for a second.
Yeah, okay, do it. It's really amazing.
This is wild stuff. Casino is the wrong word for this. Because in a casino,
they take 10% or 2%
off the top. Well, casinos are regulated.
Yeah.
You know precisely what the odds are on every game there.
Yeah.
And if a casino tries to mess with those odds, they lose their license.
Well, par mutual, it just comes out of they just take a steady 2% off the top or something.
They do that
too. I don't
know
if it's the same in casinos.
No, hedge funds take 2% off the top
yeah,
also.
Right.
But the point is, you do not bet billions of dollars.
Uh-huh.
You, if there is a lot of risk involved, you like to be, you want to be in a hedge fund business?
Mm.
You place bets that are sure things.
Well, how
Why?
About going both ways? Can
no.
you do it?
No.
That's
mythology.
Okay, no. Okay.
You want to rig the bet.
Okay, sure.
This was the bet that I just described with you with the mortgages.
Yeah, yeah.
That was a rigged bet.
Yeah.
It was like having a horse race of the lamest horses you could find.
Right.
So that you could bet on the guy who's going to, you know, or put a lame horse in the race, and then you're betting that the horse is going to lose. It was a sure thing.
Right.
Another sure thing that they've come up with, and 70 of them have been prosecuted so far, is insider trading.
Mm-hmm.
If I know something,
hasn't that always been there's a prescription against that?
Yes, but it's hard to catch them.
It's hard to keep up with them for one thing.
By
government regulatory agencies.
You don't catch them if you don't wiretap them. You don't catch them unless you have copies.
Because they're fast moving. Yeah.
Well, you have to have copies of their emails, and you have to have live conversations.
Yeah.
And here's a billion. A guy was already a billionaire.
Yeah.
Rajaraman.
Yeah, you wrote about him. Yeah.
He was already a billionaire.
He got put in. He had
9 years.
Time, didn't
he got put
he?
Away.
Yeah.
Nine
he and Madoff, right?
The thing about Madoff, it was a complete Ponzi scheme, complete scam.
Yeah.
This is a semblance of it. Still looks like they're doing something.
Yeah.
Madoff wasn't doing anything.
Yeah.
But what this guy did was he had a source on the board of directors of Goldman Sachs.
Uh-huh.
It's Friday afternoon. Mm-hmm. It's like 4:20. The stock market is closing shortly, and they're about, after it closes, they're going to announce, Goldman Sachs is during the middle of the crisis, going to announce that Warren Buffett is about to invest $10 billion in Goldman Sachs. That's the equivalent of the Good Housekeeping seal of approval.
Right,
he invests there, you know something good's going to happen.
Now, that's information you want to have to work with.
Right. And you know that the stock Monday morning.
Before everybody else knows.
Yeah, the stock's going to go up Monday morning, right?
Mm-hmm.
Has to,
yeah.
So the source calls the hedge fund guy.
Mm-hmm.
He goes out and buys, you know, hundreds of thousands of shares, sells them on Monday morning, makes $900,000 for 2 minutes worth of work, right?
Uh-huh.
$900,000.
That's good. That's more than the people here get paid.
He had to pay, well, by the way,
yeah.
My fee for you today is $1 million an hour.
Yeah, right.
So we'll see, we'll see if they feel under or overpaid.
Well, no, just catch Roberto. He's the clerk. Okay. He'll write the check.
Cash,
please. Yeah, right.
So
okay.
This guy, on what they caught him alone on, was $65 million worth of insider trades.
Yeah.
They've now caught 70 others that they've prosecuted, 70 other hedge funds that they've prosecuted.
Yeah.
And the prosecutor, this guy, Preet Bharara, who's from the New York federal prosecutor, he, in an interview, he said, look, this isn't just a few rotten apples in a barrel. This is bordering on what I consider a corrupt business model.
Corrupt business model.
The hedge fund business, he's saying, is a corrupt business model.
Wow.
That got
okay.
my attention.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
So, but this isn't it.
Yeah.
Let me give you one more.
Yeah, please.
Another way to...
You're talking about various activities of hedge funds. There's various types of things. There's scams.
Right. Different scams. Different
work.
Hedge funds have...
You take your money, you take your choice of which scam you're going to use.
Well, their information is proprietary, so they don't tell their investors how they do it. They just do it.
Yeah.
And it's
like Houdini,
okay, take this guy, Jim Cramer. You know Jim Cramer?
I know him on television.
Yeah, that's
him. He's a loud talker.
Yeah, loud talker, frenetic, you know, kind of the wild man,
right.
Beeps the horns and all that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Has a big audience. People love him.
Uh-huh.
And in a way, he's a charming guy in his own way.
Yeah.
He ran a hedge fund for 10 years.
Did he? Okay.
Yeah, before he became, got his own show.
Uh-huh.
And that hedge fund returned every year between 20 and 25%.
My
average
God.
Average 23%.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, by the way, there's another one going on right now. SAC Capital was averaging 30% return, but they're being investigated right now. Kramer, he wrote a book called Confessions of a Street Addict, but it wasn't a confession. It was just like, you know, kind of his biography.
His spin, yeah.
Yeah. But about 10 years after he left the hedge fund business, he's already on TV.
Mm.
He's a part owner of a website called thestreet.com.
Uh-huh.
And one of his young reporters is interviewing him. And he decides to really lay it out what he did.
Mm-hmm.
And it was a eye-popping interview. I'd never seen anything like it.
Is
nor
it
did anyone else.
Is the interview
you can get a transcript. They pulled it off, by the way. They pulled it. Oh God, yeah.
Uh-huh.
This was too hot.
Uh-huh.
Here's what he did. He would take a position in a stock, either to buy it or to sell it.
Yeah.
Right. Then he would slip a false rumor to his colleagues at CNBC, his comrades, the people he was already a commentator, part-time commentator at CNBC. So he would find...
Maybe over coffee. Yeah.
He would find one of the journalists there. Sometimes he would find them on the Wall Street Journal.
Yeah.
They all trusted him. He was their colleague, member of the gang. He was a hedge fund, successful hedge fund guys. And he'd tell them... something's weird is going on with RIM, maker of BlackBerry, or something bad's going on with Apple.
Yeah.
These are the early days of Apple.
Mm.
even though it wasn't true.
Right.
And they would report it, and it would drive the stock down, and he was shorting the stock. So so he manipulated his own colleagues.
He admitted to this?
He admitted to this.
Yeah, he matter of fact, any consequence at all?
No, because 10 years later, statute of limitations are long gone.
Oh!
No, he not only he admitted it, but he said that the hedge fund business, it's all fiction, fiction, fiction.
Mm-hmm.
It's all based on lies. And then he goes one step further, and he says, "If and he talked about several of the techniques that he used that were manipulating the market, things you're not allowed to do, but it's hard to catch.
Yeah.
He says, the SEC is too stupid to catch me on this stuff.
Too slow.
Too stupid.
Too understaffed.
They don't understand this. So
yeah, it was that guy who kept complaining about Madoff.
Right. You know? In this case,
it was ignored.
Yeah, exactly. In this case, what was going on is that he said, if you are not willing to do these things, you shouldn't
not
be in the
be
business.
An hedge fund, So if you're not willing to be take the pledge of the
So what do we have here? Step back and look. We've got a congressional investigation that uncovers people selling things designed to fail so they can bet against them.
Right.
And they're making billions of dollars doing that. You've got a prosecutor who thinks the whole hedge fund, is, he's catching all these people on insider trading, he thinks the whole business model is corrupt. You've got a leading hedge fund guy who's got his own television show, who well-renowned, who says...
Dropping hints.
Well, he says, if you don't manipulate the press and cheat and lie and steal, you shouldn't be in this business.
Right.
So I'm wondering, what more evidence do we need? Then we got the high-frequency traders picking your pocket every time you hit the trade button.
Right.
Tell me what else we need to show the negative value of, of what hedge funds
negative value, but where about the value added to the overall economy, and where do they stand?
They're
and where does it all stand now?
They're well, they're taking money out of your pocket.
I mean, so in view of this, in view of the... realization and things that happened and the damage that was done and everything, does everything just roll right along now?
They haven't paid a penny in it. They have not paid a penny in damages for the for what they've done to the economy.
Okay, now how can it be that there's no retribution against them or something recognizing the things you're saying by, let's say, some government agency or something? Is it, are they too big, are they too crooked to fail? Is that a new thing from on top of too big to fail? The banks are too big to fail. Got to get
too big to fail, too big to manage, too big to prosecute.
But what about the hedge funds?
The hedge funds that are inside the banks haven't been touched.
Well, no, the banks haven't been touched. They've been given great amounts of money in order to boost them up.
And there was just a recent example.
Trillions of dollars.
This London Whale example. I don't know if you heard about that. There was a hedge fund inside of J.P. Morgan Chase that lost $6 billion in a matter of weeks.
That's right.
Using insured deposits.
Insured AIG or no?
Insured by the federal government. Our deposits.
Oh, right.
They were playing with excess. They were playing with excess deposits that they didn't have investment opportunities to. They gave them to this internal hedge fund. He went out and gambled and lost $6 billion.
Wow. What about AIG's role in all of this? AIG is a super, everybody was reinsuring against loss and dealing with risk things, and they had they were covering so many, but did they figure into the overall thing of the collapse in 2008? And then Lehman Brothers collapsed, it didn't go. But I'm just wondering about insurance, because if you're, derivatives, you've written on derivatives and swaps and things, that's to deal with the various levels, supposedly insurance, commercial insurance against the various levels of risk that exist within the overall market, you know? And where does all that fit in, derivatives and stocks that came in about 1980?
That's a longer story. I have
it's not related.
Oh, it's definitely related. Uh-huh. I have a lecture that I did that people can get on C-SPAN Book TV.
Oh, I heard you was on there. That was really good.
I have an hour and 20-minute lecture on
On the derivatives?
On derivatives, yes.
Oh, good. Well, we can recommend that to people. But
firstly, people
touch on it, maybe. That's all.
Well, that scam I told you about designing something to fail and then betting against it.
Right.
Well, that scam was entirely based on derivatives. They owned none of the mortgages. You can place a bet without owning anything.
Yeah.
What they do is they if any of the viewers know what fantasy sports is about or fantasy baseball, it's another whole world. But basically, people gamble by pretending that they own certain baseball players.
Oh.
So there's 700 baseball players, but there are 15 million people creating teams as if they own the real baseball players, but they don't own them.
Yeah, right.
So they were creating mortgage-backed securities as if they owned the mortgages, but they didn't own anything.
Now, who was doing that?
The banks and the hedge
funds. Banks and the hedge funds. Okay, yeah. Right.
So, I know you're very curious about AAG.
Yeah.
Huge. What was going on?
And had to be bailed out.
Yeah, had to be bailed out.
Or the company, or the whole system would, the whole international thing would collapse. So they told us.
Okay. It might have.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm.
The story is a little complicated. The first thing I need to tell you is
you
that
I
run through this. Yeah, it took an hour and 20 minutes to do it, but let me give you the 20-second version.
We only have about 12 minutes left.
Okay. And I want to get to one more big scam. AIG only rated AAA mortgages.
Okay. Yeah.
AAA mortgage-backed securities. Mm-hmm. But the problem was the way those securities are structured was completely BS.
Yeah.
And so AIG thought they were insuring those securities against failure and that they were AAA, but they were really not AAA.
Right.
So because the rating agencies were, I think.
Were they bought off? Were they in cahoots?
Yeah, I think they went to the highest bidder.
Really?
I consider the rating agencies the equivalent of lapdogs.
Well, that's really amazing. That's really, really amazing.
So that's another whole story.
That's Moody's and S&P and all that.
Some of my best friends work there.
But
That's a
something
mess.
Should be done with
anyway,
them or
AIG,
about them or something should be done. You said one little throwaway line, we ought to break up all the big banks. That was kind of a little biggie.
Well, I think you have to.
Yeah, really.
I think
and the rating agencies and the hedge funds. We only have a few minutes left. What the solution to all this is?
I need to make one.
Okay.
We'll get into this. I need to make one more point. Not only do they produce negative value, they get a tax break.
Right, a tax break.
They pay a lower tax rate than you do. They have
a
special tax break called carried interest.
Uh-huh.
So they pay a lower interest. They pay a lower federal tax rate than anybody else at that income. So not only are the richest of the rich, not only do they not produce positive value for the economy, they get a tax break to boost.
It's
so
amazing.
What do you do about it? Right. Okay, number one, you get rid of that tax break. Number two, you put a financial transaction tax on a sales tax on every buying and selling of every share, of every derivative, a little tax that wipes out that hidden tax that
how could it be and what would be the political context for bringing that about?
It'd be there's a movement building. Yeah. 11 countries in Europe are starting to do it.
I wonder if I could take a brief second to say that you are going to bless our Association of Cable Access. So those of you who may be viewing, he's going to be our speaker at a meeting. Do you mind if I announce that?
On
Monday the 29th, the day this program is airing, you're watching it now on cable television or around the world, he's going to come to 241 West 36th Street and give a presentation on this. It'll have to be a little quicker. I think it's going to be more like a half an hour. You have to put it all into a half an hour, but take questions.
Best.
So I'll let you know that it's going to be there at 241 West 36th Street. And anyone interested in this interesting person and the interesting theme that he's talking about are invited to come, and you could give me a call and let me know if you want details. So anyway,
great.
Now we're on to some of the solutions.
There's a website called robinhoodtax.org.
Yeah.
You can find out all about the financial transaction tax. Consider it a sin tax on Wall Street.
Okay, right.
We could raise enough money from that little tax.
Yeah, I should think.
To pay so that every kid in this country could go to a public college, university, community college, tuition free.
Wow, okay. It used to be tuition free.
Yeah, it could be like that again if we had the syntax on Wall Street.
Wow.
In terms of the banks.
Now, what would it take? Legislation?
Yeah.
It would have to take up consciousness?
No.
Simple. Hasn't there been enough demonstration of what we did and everything and the difficulties? There'd be great support for that among the general society of this country if they could understand
it? Of course, there'd be
great
support.
But you getting that message out might help the understanding
and
bring about a policy change.
Yeah, the National Nurses United, it's a union of nurses.
Yeah.
They're pushing this thing hard.
Okay,
RobinHoodTax.org.
Okay, RobinHoodTax.org.
RobinHoodTax.org.
Okay, good. Okay, good.
.org.
Yeah.
In terms of the banks, there's another great group out there called the Public Banking Institute.
Okay.
And what they're advocating is the creation of state banks. You know, one of the most conservative states in the country, North Dakota, is the only state that has a public bank. It had no trouble during, it's like a wholesale bank. It supports their 80 community banks.
Okay.
The state deposits its revenues from taxes, sales taxes, licenses, fees, into this bank. And then the bank it makes loans to local community banks and to students for tuition and whatnot.
And North Dakota.
And it's profitable.
Yeah.
The profits go to the state revenue. Uh-huh. This is North Dakota, one of the reddest states.
They got a lot of oil or something going on
but
there too.
They're really conservative.
Yeah, right.
Being a Democrat there is like an endangered species. They have this bank. They make a huge amount of money. They had no problems during the crash.
Uh-huh.
They didn't need any assistance. Because they didn't gamble.
You think there's a model there relevant to the rest of the country?
Absolutely. 20 other states are investigating it.
Yeah, okay.
And the Public Banking Institute is helping them.
Uh-huh.
And they're having a big conference on June 2nd in California. Go to their website, Public Banking Institute. It's a great group, very small group, but
these
very
are
smart
some,
people.
These are some suggestions for how we might move ahead. Yeah,
because you need to break up Wall Street. The banks themselves can't help it anymore. They're criminal institutions.
Mm-hmm.
They break the law with impunity.
Yeah.
They're right now.
But
right
they're also politically tied in.
Of course,
they?
They're politically tied in.
So you're talking. They had a movement called Occupy, where people are saying we want real major confirmation or transformation.
I'm trying to list some of
those things that might be on the agenda of the Occupy mentality.
Of course, if we had a public banks in every state, Wall Street would have $1 trillion less to play with.
Wow.
Because the money that goes to state governments get deposited in Wall Street banks.
Yeah.
And that money could be put to use for the states.
Mm-hmm.
It could create 10 million extra jobs. You know, North Dakota, they loan out the money. For every $100,000 they loan out, you have to create one job.
Oh, really?
Unemployment's the lowest almost in the country, in North Dakota, for a lot of reasons. They have oil and
they have
things.
Oil, yeah.
But
yeah.
it's also, they have a very smart bank there.
Yeah.
And even Republicans support it.
Uh-huh.
So I think this movement could catch on.
Is there an individual associated with putting that through in North Dakota, a governor or somebody in a position?
1919, it was the populist movement.
1919?
Yep. Been there since 1919.
Oh, okay. I was looking for somebody a little more contemporary, but
1919.
Okay. There
now
could
you
be a leader of the movement.
Well, the leader of the movement, this woman named Ellen Brown.
I'm glad it's a woman.
Yeah,
that'd be good to have a rule.
She's written a very interesting book called Web of Debt.
Okay.
She and this guy, Mark Armstrong, who used to a former finance person with IBM, are the people who run this Public Banking Institute. They're spectacular people. So, yes, there are things we can do. Wall Street has to be broken up, and we basically, it's a simple formula. Money has to be moved. This wasteful resources here have to go from Wall Street to Main Street, and it's the only way we could take back our country from high finance.
Yeah. What are your predictions, Nick the Greek, on the prospect that because it's not only the banks and the finance people and the political people, it's also the established media. There is the general need to inform the public about it. What do you think the odds are, Mr. Nick the Greek? And do you want to take a put on the bet about whether or not we're going to be able to pull this off, or is everything, because so many people are so used to just saying, well, it's all rotten, but we just get used to it. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, sure.
That seems to be the attitude of the country now. Let them go with all their ill-gotten gains, and we'll just shuffle along like good serfs as always we have. You understand what I'm saying?
I understand completely what you're saying.
Here, you're talking about a major transformation.
Right, but see, Occupy Wall Street showed us that kind of political force, that kind of demonstration showed us that the American people were angry at Wall Street.
But they also...
They changed the conversation virtually overnight. A bunch of ragtag kids operation, whatever it was. The problem was the rest of us viewed it as a spectator sport.
Yeah, right.
Had a movement really coalesced with the structure of something like the populist movement back in the 1880s, they had 4,000 lecturers going around the country talking about how Wall Street was organized and how we had to take an alternative banking system to the one in New York.
Right. We tried to set it up after the 30s and everything, and then everything over time, it just went wabi wabi.
Right, it requires upheaval. It requires organizing.
Yeah.
It requires not just a bunch of young people occupying a park. It requires a mass movement.
Yeah, and it also requires an understanding, an intelligent understanding of this. And you are in the business of trying to make that available to greater numbers of the population that could be part of building
right.
a
and
movement.
I think people are ready for something like this.
Yeah.
The progressive community has to decide that this is the number one hazard to go after.
Uh-huh.
We're splintered into a thousand different movements.
Uh-huh.
There was a chance to come together
yeah.
around doing something about Wall Street.
Yeah.
And I think that's what could unite us.
Yeah, but they did break us up pretty easy, didn't they? I mean, it seems to be.
Ourselves up.
Well, okay.
We watched.
But the police came in with under Mr. Bloomberg's the thing and everything. They did it here in New York, and there was just it was like quasi-fascist kind of.
We didn't need to have just though. We could have had demonstrations at public libraries. We could have had sit-ins and education things at high schools.
Okay, why didn't we have sufficient enough to keep it alive? Or did it? Is it still alive?
I think there
it's happening around
the world.
The
anger is still there.
Yeah, it's there.
It's waiting for some group of young people, I think, to build an organization that has real structure to it so that we can do things.
Uh-huh.
We need things to do.
Yeah.
I think that the National Nurses United is heading in the right
Good.
Direction.
Okay.
I'm hoping that some other trade unions will
yeah.
head in this direction. I'm hoping that other progressive groups will head in this direction.
Because
I think I'm living proof of this.
Right.
I can go on conservative talk radio shows and no one's going to argue against me about, no one's arguing on behalf of Wall Street.
Yeah. That's right. Yeah, that is true, isn't it, there?
Yeah.
And
so
yet there they are raking in great profits.
Low-hanging fruit.
Okay, well, it's a really good thing. You said right from the beginning you had a dedication in your life to being able to explain complicated things to the general society. An admirable call. Pattern recognizing, seeing things in a big pattern. It's called for and everything, and you're doing a magnificent job of it. And I hope you're absolutely right. I'm a little chagrined that there has been a successful clampdown on them, and they try, as always they have, to blame the masses for not recognizing the sterling leadership qualities of the so-called leadership class. But the leadership class is bereft of ideas that can be really relevant to a dawning new future that is very, very hopeful that you're trying to help make available to the consciousness of the average citizen that could build a movement to achieve it. Admirable work.
Thank you, and I think the spirit of the people that were doing Occupy Wall Street, and a lot of the talent that was there, I think is going to have a chance to rise again. I hope the rest of us are ready.
I would hope that would be the case. I really would. I would think, and also I would hope to think that maybe this little venue, this public access, there are these public access places across the country. They link by the internet now, and that they might be a place where people could repair in order to get some ideas about. Understanding it, much in the way you've made very clear to me and to others and everything, and I congratulate you enormously on that work, and I'm really happy you're going to be able to come and talk to us tonight on the 29th at our place, and all are invited to come in and attend if you can. Les, thank you very, very
Thanks
much,
so much for, having
for such
me.
A very, very well-led life that continues admirably, and I thank you very much for all that, and in the audience, thank you for tuning in. It's your pleasure to have the lessons of perception of Jes Leopold written. And the book is, one more time, How to Make $1 Million an Hour.
Why Hedge Funds Get Away with Siphoning Off America's Wealth.
One part of a very large equation that ought to be understood by us all. And I thank you very much for helping to...